So in 1981, Richard Feynman proposed the idea of creating devices which are based on the laws of quantum mechanics that are capable of performing calculations that are impossible on classical computers. So as a result of this, there have been numerous advancements in the field of quantum information processing relating to quantum simulation and quantum computation. So in order to realize a functional quantum computer, there are numerous requirements which I'm needed to be taken into account, but for simplicity, I just narrowed it down to two. So the first case is having a system with long coherence time to achieve strong interaction. So this particular requirement can actually be met by using the hyperfine levels of atoms, which serve as a good candidate for this application. But another important requirement is to exploit strong and tunable two or more body interactions, which with the introduction of Rydberg atoms, this particular requirement could also be fulfilled as a result of its exceptional properties, such as its huge polarizability and also the large dipole moment. So this is going to be the order of my talk. I'm going to first introduce Rydberg atoms, talk about the strong interactions which they undergo, and then go on to talk about the dipole blockade mechanism. Then I want to talk about how this dipole blockade mechanism is used in quantum gate operations, and also just show some examples related to the use of this blockade mechanism for implementation in quantum gates. Then I want to talk about the theoretical background behind the study, and also some useful approaches which we used to understand the non-trivial quantum dynamics that undergoes during interacting Rydberg atoms. So the first question is, what are Rydberg atoms? Rydberg atoms are highly excited atoms. So these atoms are known to have a high principal quantum number as a result of promoting its outermost electron to a highly excited state. So as a result of this, there seem to be like hydrogen-like atoms, which their physical properties can be described by the Bohr's model of atom. So they are having some certain characteristics which are of huge interest to researchers. For instance, they are long-lived states, which they have a decay that scales in the order of milliseconds in comparison to traditional states, which are in the order of nanoseconds. Then also, they also have huge sizes. But important to us is the large dipole moments, which as a result of their high polarizability that scales in the order n to the 7. So as a result of this, they are sensitive to fields. And this leads to strong interaction between the neighboring atoms, which is also dependent on the interatomic distance between these atoms. So as a result of this, you can classify the interaction regime into two. So the first case is the natural van der Waals interaction regime, and then the second is the strong dipole-dipole interaction regime. So this is dependent on the interatomic distance, because in the first case, for the van der Waals regime, you have in a case where the distance is larger. Then when they are much closer to each other, you have the dipole-dipole interaction regime, which is where you observe certain phenomena like the dipole blockade mechanism. So the next step is to understand what this Rydberg dipole blockade means. Basically, it's when you excite, it's when the excitation of more than one atom to its Rydberg state is avoided due to the strong interaction that undergoes between these systems, thereby shifting the energy state of the other atoms to be off resonance with the excitation field at this close distance. So imagine, for example, we have two atoms. So let's say these atoms are undergoing some form of interaction. Maybe it could be the van der Waals, it could be the strong dipole-dipole interaction. So their computational basis can be written in the canonical basis GG, which is where both atoms are in the ground state, RG or GR, where these atoms are excited to, where just one atom is excited to its Rydberg state, and RR, where both atoms are excited to its Rydberg state. So the Hamiltonian can be diagonalized to having four states, which is the first, the ground state, where both atoms are in its ground state, both atoms are in its Rydberg state, and also the symmetric and anti-symmetric Eigen states. So, taking a look at this new system, we know that the case of the anti-symmetric Eigen state is a zero energy state. Hence, this particular state can be decoupled from the other states, the other three states. But also, now let's imagine that these particular systems are exhibiting this strong interaction. So as a result of this, this particular state where both atoms are in its Rydberg state become off resonance with the transition. So as a result of this, we can also decouple this state. So imagine, after when you decouple this thing, we then have an effective two-level system where only one atom is excited to its prepared state. This particular symmetric eddy state is said to be maximally entangled as the two atoms are perfectly anticorrelated. Basically, entanglement means a phenomenon in which the quantum states of two or more particles have to be described with reference to each other, even though they are spatially separated. So, based on the feasibility of using this Rydberg blockade to achieve entanglement of pairs of atoms, Jarosz proposed the idea of exploiting this Rydberg blockade for entangling atom pairs at distances more than 1 micron. So the next step is to understand what is the difference between a classical computer and a quantum computer. Basically, it's the fact that, as we all know, classical computers work in bits, whereas the classical computers work in bits and logic gates, whereas quantum computers work with qubits and quantum gates, which is just a quantum logic circuit of few qubits. So this implementation was demonstrated by Safman, where he demonstrated that, imagine you have a set of atoms which are exhibiting some form of interaction. So there's one particular atom which is excited to its Rydberg state, which says as the control atom. And this particular control atom thereby pushes the other atoms, which are the target atoms, off resonance with the excitation field. So if these particular control atoms and target atoms are properly coupled, the evolution of these target atoms can be controlled by the quantum state of the control atoms. As a result of this, the evolution matrix can be expressed in this new computational base, which is represented by the control Z gate. And this control Z gate can be further converted to the control NOT gate, which sets a basis for standard universal quantum gate operations, which you can get more information about it in this slide here, relating to the C-NOT gate, the Tivoli gate, and also the phase gate. So we wanted to understand these non-trivial quantum dynamics that undergoes between interacting Rydberg atoms. So as a result of this, we needed to employ two particular methods. The first being the density matrix formalism, which is based on the master equation, and also the Monte Carlo wave function approach. So let's imagine we have a two-level system. So this system having a ground state and an excited state. So the state of this particular system can be described by the wave function, which where the sum of the square of the norm of the probability amplitude is equal to 1. Then the Hamiltonian of this particular system, that means including a case where it's been interacting with the field. The Hamiltonian can be represented as a sum of the free part and the interaction part, which we take into account the detuning, simply meaning detuning being setting the laser frequency to be slightly off resonance with the transition. So we can further express the temporal evolution of the system's wave function, which can be described by the Schrödinger equations. Imagine you have a case or a condition where this system is in resonance with the excitation field, meaning that the detuning is equal to 0. You have the probability amplitude expressed as this, which the pulse area is just simply equal to omega t. So we wanted to understand the evolution of this system, and we plotted the population of the state as a function of the pulse area. Here we can see that in the case where you have a pi over 2 pulse, you have an equal superposition of the ground and the excited state. But whereas in the case where you have a pi pulse, you have an inversion between these two states. But in the case where you have a 2 pi pulse or even multiples of pi's of pulse, you have an oscillation where it goes from the ground state to the excited state, returning back to the ground state. So the next step was to implement the density matrix formalism, which basically, how you do it is to introduce the density operators, which the temporal evolution can be expressed in the generalized form, which is simply the review for Neumann equations, which the density operator has setting elements, which it has the diagonal elements and the off-diagonal elements, with the diagonal elements representing the population and the off-diagonal terms representing the coherence, which the derivative of this can obtain the optical block equation. So, imagine you introduce multi-level systems. In the case of multi-level systems, adiabatic passage methods are possible, and one of the well-known adiabatic passage methods is the Stirac method, which is the stimulated Raman adiabatic passage. So let's imagine we have this three-level system in a lambda configuration. So this, imagine that the initial state, imagine that the population is in the initial state. So fulfilling the adiabatic condition, traditional stira consists of letting the dark state evolve from the state 1 to the state 3 without populating the state 2 as a result of the illumination of pulses in a counterintuitive sequence. So the Hamiltonian of this system under the electric dipole approximation and the rotating wave approximation can be represented as this, where if this Hamiltonian is diagonalized under the two photon resonance, you have certain eigen states, which the psi zero represents the dark state, which is a zero energy state. So here what we did was we plotted the population of different states, and what we wanted to see was how this dark state evolved. So we can see a very strong and robust population transfer as a result of this counterintuitive sequence. So one of the main advantages of this Dirac method is that it is less prone to be affected by fluctuations in the field intensity and also in the shape of the pulses. All right, so the second and actually most important part of the thesis was the Monte Carlo wave function approach. This particular method was developed by Mormon, Kastin and Dalibar in 1992. At this time, there were numerous other methods that were under development. For example, the quantum trajectory method, which was developed by Carmichael. So basically, it was also called the quantum jump approach, which is very useful for simulating open quantum systems. And this is done by evaluating single stochastic quantum trajectories. So as a result of this, we know that this particular method is stochastic in nature. So there are a lot of intrinsic errors. As a result of these intrinsic errors, the statistical average is taken over the total number of trajectories, which gives the same result as the master equation. This Monte Carlo wave function approach also describes the system in terms of the wave function of size n rather than an ensemble in the case of the density matrix of n to the power 2. The quantum jump method simply is when, due to absorption, an observed system can occasionally switch between states, distinct states, which accounts for dissipation and also occurs at each step with some certain probability. So here you have the case of the work done by Dalibar, Kastin and Mormon, where they demonstrated the first case for single trajectories, where you can observe the quantum jumps observed in at random points of the evolution in time. Then also, they also demonstrated it in the case where there's an ensemble of 100 Monte Carlo wave functions. Here they made a comparison with the dotted point being the case of the master equations with perfect agreement. So the next step here was to understand how to implement this Monte Carlo wave function. So let's bring back our two-level system, as we said before, the ground and the excited state. So in the rotating wave, the Hamiltonian can be represented as such, where the state of the atomic quantized field at a time, let's say T, is represented as a product of the atom and the quantized electromagnetic field in the ground state. So after a certain time, let's say dt, spontaneous photons may be emitted, and let's reset the dt to be far less than the inverse of the decay, the rapid frequency, and the detuning, so that at most just one spontaneous photon is emitted between the time t and t plus dt. So the wave function after dt can be expressed as a sum of the wave functions accounting for the different states, where the probability of the excited states, which we expressed in the thesis as dp, is just simply the square of the norm of the wave functions accounting for that particular state, where for spontaneous emission during dt can be expressed further as this. So we know that the probability amplitude values a prime after dt can be obtained from the evolution of the atom initial state with effective non-emission Hamiltonian, which we represented as h prime. So the next step was to follow up with the quantum jump protocol, which we wanted to numerically analyze the photon detection. As a result of this, you have to select a random number to be chosen between 0 and 1 in order to simulate the randomness of the Yerdanian measurement results. So here, after photon detection, we observed that in the case of the two-level system, there are two cases, which the first case is for the detection of 0 photons, where the random number is greater than the probability dp. Then the second case is the case for detection of one photon. So we wanted to also, a major part of the study too was to understand a comparison between the Monte Carlo wave function and the density matrix formality. So here it's done by introducing the density operator, which basically is the average over a number of trajectories. And here we consider it at the time t plus dt, where we obtain the density matrix elements represented by the Weyl von Neumann equations, including the Lindblad operator terms. Here, this basically represents the same results as the work of Dalibard, Kasten, and Malma, where we represented for the first case of the just single trajectory and the case of 100 Monte Carlo wave functions. We can see a perfect agreement with their results, where here we plotted for the case of the ground state and also for the case of the excited state. So extending this method to a three-level system, for still for a single atom, the wave function after dt is also the sum, but now for the three states, the sum of the wave function, but for the three states, where probability for obtaining spontaneous emission in the transition eg is represented as dpeg, and whereas the probability of spontaneous emission in the transition dp is in the transition re is represented as dpre. So in the three-level case, we have three cases. So now the first case is the case where there's no photon detection. The second case is where there's spontaneous emission in the transition E to G. And while the third case is the case where there's spontaneous emission between the transition R to E. So here we extended the plot, but now doing it for an ensemble of 100 Monte Carlo wave functions. We plotted for the three different states and then making a comparison where the black line represents the case of the quantum jump method. And also the red line represents the case for the master equation. We can see a perfect agreement between these two different methods. So, the final part, or the also very important part of the thesis, was to understand interacting Rydberg atoms, right? And first we considered the case of two-level atoms, where we assume that these two-level atoms are experiencing some form of interaction, and this interaction is a strong dipole-dipole interaction. So this new system can be represented in the canonical base GGGR, RG, and RR, where the Hamiltonian is represented as a four-dimensional Hamiltonian with the energy shift included as a result of this strong dipole-dipole interaction. So in order to understand, first of all, how it works, and also just to make a test to compare the case of the Monte Carlo wave function with the master equation, I made a plot of the both approaches. And here I set the interaction energy to be equal to zero for an average of 100 Monte Carlo wave functions, which we see also a perfect agreement between both of them. But importantly was this result, which here I plotted the case of the different states, the population of the different states, and also for the Monte Carlo wave function approach, for the density matrix approach. But here I set the interaction energy to be 0.5 omega, and including some form of decay. We can see that in this case, the population is being shared among the different states without a decent suppression of the state RR, which is actually the goal, because we want to observe the Rydberg blocking mechanism here. So in order to understand how this interaction energy influences the population of the states and also the suppression of these particular states, the population for these different states were plotted as a function of the interaction energy, where we can see from the results here that for an interaction energy of 3.5 omega, we observe a suppression in RR states, where in the case of 7.2 omega, we observe most of the populations going to the state where only one Rydberg atom is excited. So in order to take these particular parameters and put it to perform simulations, we took an interaction energy of 4.5 omega, where we plotted it for the case of the state RR, and then we include some form of decay to obtain the results where we observe a very perfect suppression of this state RR. So extending this method to a three-level system, in this case now you have the new canonical basis, which is represented as this. So we plotted the population in the state RR, where we demonstrated quantum jumps, And then the next step was also to take some of the parameters which we obtained from the previous parts of the study. For example, using interaction energy as 4.5 omega, we were able to make plots of the different states. But in this case now, it was grouped into three groups. The first group is a group where no Rydberg atom is excited. The second case is where only one Rydberg atom is excited. And then the third case is where both Rydberg atoms are excited. We can observe from these particular figures that the population was shared between the states that either no Rydberg atom was excited or just one Rydberg atom was excited. Whereas in the case where both Rydberg atoms were excited, there was a perfect suppression in this case, perfectly demonstrating the concept of dipole blockade. So to summarize all I've been talking about, the study, as we know, focused on Rydberg excitation blockade effect in strongly interacting atoms. We implemented two methods here, which are the density matrix approach and also the Monte Carlo wave approach, and also showing the effects of interaction energy due to the diatomic distance between the atoms, showing how it avoids the excitation of multiple Rydberg atoms. Also, STIRAP was demonstrated with its counterintuitive sequences of the illumination poles, and also showing how it fulfills the adiabatic conditions by following the dark states. Then also, we introduced the concept of Rydberg atoms, the exceptional properties, the reason why they are being demanded by most researchers in application, and also showing some numerical results which relates to the Monte Carlo wave function and the Rydberg blockade mechanism, which shows a good agreement with previous studies. So these are some useful references which I just put here to just have a little explanation on. So in this case of the fourth reference, this is one of the first or pioneering papers on Monte Carlo wave function method. And then the second is the work by, well, the proposal by Jash, where so far has had, I think, 1,200 citations, because it has set the basis for implementing that blockade mechanism in achieving the design of fast quantum gates. Then the first reference relates to implementation by experimentalists of this particular concept proposed by Jash. And then the third reference relates to implementing these Rydberg atoms in quantum information, so a broad review of it, both theoretically and experimentally.